Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Self-Compassion for Dummies by Stephen Hickman, Doctor of Psychology. Narrated by Steve Menasche. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Introduction. It's simple, really. You just want to be happy and free from unnecessary struggle and suffering. Am I right? I can make that statement so boldly because this is actually true of every human being who has ever lived and ever will live. The issue, though, is that perhaps you are struggling more than you would like. Something doesn't feel right about how you feel, and in particular, something doesn't feel right about how you treat yourself much of the time. Perhaps you have a constant virtual companion that provides negative commentary on your every move, often referred to as an inner critic. Or maybe you find yourself feeling isolated and alone, or lost in rumination and worry. If any of this sounds familiar, and you've thought that perhaps more self-compassion might help, your instincts are right on target. When your dear friends have a hard time, struggle, fail, or fall short, you know just how to be there for them, support them, and encourage them. But somehow, when you face the same kinds of challenges in your life, the narrative is different. You beat yourself up. You demand perfection, or you simply surrender, feeling defeated, isolated, and overwhelmed. But at the same time, there is a part of you watching this all unfold and whispering in your ear that there has to be a better way. That part of you that simply wants to be happy is the part of you that saw self-compassion as a way out of this painful cycle. And it was that part of you that picked up this book. Bravo. You've made perhaps the most important step you can take toward building a kinder and more productive relationship with yourself. Self-compassion has been scientifically demonstrated to promote resilience, improve mood, promote nourishing relationships, and motivate people to make positive changes in their life. Most importantly, greater self-compassion promotes joy and satisfaction. And who doesn't want more joy and satisfaction in their life? About this book. I have taken to telling colleagues that I have written the most ironic title in the For Dummies series. Think about it. Self-compassion for dummies seems like the ultimate oxymoron, like jumbo shrimp or deafening silence. And really, the worst way to start an adventure in treating yourself with kindness and respect. After all, calling yourself a dummy seems a lot like yelling at your kid to make them quiet down. But taken another way, being willing to purchase a book called Self-Compassion for Dummies means that you are humble and receptive to change, which is actually exactly where you need to be to get the most out of this book. This book will help you explore the possibility of cultivating a kinder and more supportive relationship with yourself, and then guide you through a whole series of exercises, meditations, and reflections designed to help you cultivate greater self-compassion over time. The road ahead will not necessarily be easy, but the potential rewards are significant. Each chapter tackles a different aspect of life and gives you concrete and specific tools and tips for helping self-compassion truly make a difference in your life. Don't feel confined to progressing through the book chapter by chapter systematically, if that isn't your style, but do know that to some degree, each chapter builds a bit on the ones preceding it. And since I have established that you are a humble person by nature, be willing to notice when you feel stuck and simply go back and reread or repractice something that didn't land quite right. You can even go back to previous chapters and re-experience them with fresh eyes from time to time. Also, feel free to skip sidebars that pop up throughout the book. If the subject doesn't resonate, maybe it doesn't apply to you right now. You won't miss anything crucial if you skip them. Follow your heart and see where it leads. Your practice of self-compassion hopefully won't end with this book, but instead will have only just begun. Foolish assumptions. In writing this book, I made a few assumptions about who you are and why you are here. You have an intuition or an idea that self-compassion may be good for you, but you aren't quite sure where to start or if you're up to the challenge. You are willing to be humble and receptive and maintain an open mind about this sort of thing and give it a go, as they say in England. You have a sense that you are kinder to other people than you are to yourself, especially when encountering adversity, failure, and pain. You are cautiously curious about meditation and self-compassion practice, but you have a few lingering reservations about this whole endeavor. There is nothing tricky or technical about treating yourself with compassion, but it does require a willingness to approach it warm-heartedly and with curiosity. All I ask is for your open heart and mind, and some patience, not only with me, but more importantly, with yourself. Icons used in this book. In writing this book, I have provided you with little flags or pointers to draw your attention to particular kinds of information that may be noteworthy for different reasons. Here's a key to what those icons mean. From years of teaching people mindfulness, meditation, and self-compassion, I have identified certain helpful hints or ways of getting unstuck when you find yourself struggling. Think of these icons as pointing to words for the wise. Remember. Sometimes things bear repeating so that they stay with you when you really need them. These are those kinds of important points that can never be repeated enough. Technical stuff. This icon denotes information that you might find interesting, but it isn't critical to your practice of self-compassion. Feel free to skip over it if you like. Play. You'll see this icon next to exercises that have downloadable online audio. Beyond the book. In addition to the material in the print or ebook you're reading right now, this product comes with a number of companion downloadable audio recordings of key meditations, reflections, and exercises that you will encounter in the book. You are invited to make full use of them along the way or after you've finished reading the book. To access or download the audio tracks, go to dummies.com/go/self-compassion-FD. It's wise to bookmark the link so you can easily access the recordings when you need them. Most often, the practice of self-compassion happens in real time, meaning in moments of difficulty, challenge, or even overwhelm. Thus, having the practices at your fingertips is very handy because life doesn't wait to serve you up its challenges until you are sitting safely at home in front of your computer with your bunny slippers on. This book also comes with an online cheat sheet with additional tips. To access this, go to dummies.com and type Self-Compassion for Dummies Cheat Sheet in the search box. Where to go from here? The fundamental practice of self-compassion is to ask yourself, what do I need? And then to act on that question. Let that be the guiding principle for how you approach this whole book. Look over the table of contents and ask yourself, what do I need just now? I only ask you to be patient with yourself and this process, to not be overly ambitious or to try too hard to get it right. Often those who need self-compassion the most are also incredibly ambitious and perfectionistic. So if you recognize this tendency in you, maybe, whoa, big fella, hold on there a minute, may be in order. Whatever you feel you need in this practice of self-compassion, I urge you to consider at least taking some time with Part 2, Chapter 3, before you venture too far into the practice. This chapter sets the stage for the challenges as well as the opportunities of self-compassion practice, and it provides some useful tips for how to get the most out of your journey while also taking good care of yourself on the way. If you are someone who likes to focus and go deep with a new skill or ability, you have my enthusiastic permission to spend a fair amount of time on Part 2 to build up your resources of self-compassion and help to make them a part of your way of being. Returning again and again to some of these core practices and concepts is a great way to be reminded that while it isn't always easy, the practice of self-compassion can be quite simple. Think of Part 2 as the fundamentals of self-compassion, and the later chapters as more advanced topics or applications of the core elements. All in all, I invite you to browse, meander, and dip in and out of this book like a delicious buffet of goodness, which it is. Above all, be kind and patient with yourself, and be brave as well. If you have the intrepid spirit of an adventurer, set forth boldly and explore. If you are of a milder, more hesitant nature, come on in and dip your toe in the water. Everyone is welcome, and everyone belongs. Finally, I would love to hear from you about your experience in this book. Check out my website at drstephenhickman.com or email me at steve@centerformsc.org. Part 1. Getting Started with Self-Compassion. In this part, discover how to begin to ask yourself the fundamental question of self-compassion. What do I need? Find out what science tells us about self-compassion. Explore how self-compassion may not be what you think and may actually be the opposite of what you think. Develop some basic skills to create the best inner space and equip you to get the most from self-compassion practice. Chapter 1. Exploring Self-Compassion. In this chapter, becoming a friend to yourself. Exploring the three components and yin and yang of self-compassion. Discovering the fundamental question of self-compassion. Getting to know the Mindful Self-Compassion Program and its founders. Welcome to the next step on a journey to greater self-compassion in your life. Take a moment to appreciate the road you have traveled thus far and how you came to be holding this book. It is probably safe to say that if you are reading these words, you do not consider yourself skilled at being kind to yourself or treating yourself compassionately when you have a hard time. After all, those people don't buy books like this. Maybe you're self-compassion curious, and you are here because you have become increasingly aware that being hard on yourself, perfectionistic, and prone to bouts of shame, and maybe even self-loathing, is not serving you. In fact, this way of being with yourself has caused you a great deal of emotional pain and impacted your ability to do what you want to do in life and to have the things you most desire, like joy, happiness, and satisfaction. Maybe you've observed a repeating pattern of destructive relationships, unfulfilling jobs, or unhealthy habits that you engage in to mute the pain you feel. It may be pain or struggle or stress that brought you through the door, so to speak, but before you move on, consider looking just a little bit below the surface of those painful challenges. Specifically, the reason you took action and are seeking to find out about self-compassion is actually not because of discomfort or pain that you feel. Instead, it is another part of you that deeply understands that you deserve better. That motivated and moved you. At your very core is a deep desire to be happy and free from suffering. It is this quiet but persistent voice and inclination of the heart that moves you to seek out something better for yourself. The practice of self-compassion is really about accessing that small voice and giving it space to grow and expand. Becoming more self-compassionate is like pulling weeds around a tender seedling full of potential and beauty and bounty so that it can reach its full potential. In this metaphor, you are both the seedling and the gardener. So, with a fair amount of patience, persistence, and kind intention towards yourself, you can tend this garden and harvest the fruits of your labor. You actually have everything you need inside of you to do this kind-hearted, important work. And my intention is to support you in accessing those inner resources that you may doubt that you possess and discover how to embrace them to fulfill your potential as a living, loving human being no less deserving of your own love and affection than any other person on the planet. Befriending yourself, a splendid new relationship. If you're like most people, you are a really good friend. When your pals have a hard time, when they miss out on a promotion or go through a divorce, you know how to respond in just the right way. You can comfort and soothe if needed. You may inspire self-confidence or cheer them on at other times. And you're generally their rock when times are tough. It's what you do. You're a mensch, as they say in Yiddish, a good person, a stand-up guy. Not always, not perfectly, but you do your best and your friends appreciate your kind intention. But maybe something different happens when the one who struggles is you. Take a moment to pause and consider this brief, guided reflection drawn from the Mindful Self-Compassion Program. 1. Pause for a moment and allow your mind to settle and to become aware of your body as it sits just where it is. Create a brief pause between reading and reflecting. 2. Call to mind a situation when a close friend was having a hard time. Perhaps they failed a test in school, or they interviewed for a desirable job and they didn't get it, or they accidentally said something that made someone angry at them. 3. See if you can recall how you responded to your friend in this situation. Maybe recall how you found out about the situation and what you did upon hearing it. What were the kinds of things you said to your friend? See if you can remember the tone of voice you used or body posture at the time. 4. Now take a moment to consider another scenario. Think of a time when you faced a misfortune. Maybe you made a proposal at work that was rejected by management. Or you said something that upset a romantic partner and they ended the relationship. 5. Call to mind what went on inside your mind and heart at the time. Again, how did you react? See if you can recall the words you used with yourself in the aftermath of the event. And even if you can't recall the exact words, you may recall the tone of your inner voice. You may even recall how your body felt to hear this or what emotions came up. 6. Compare these two situations. Is there a difference in how you respond to a friend versus how you respond to yourself under similar circumstances? If what you discovered in the previous reflection was that you are harder on yourself than you are on your friends when things go wrong, you are in very good company. Researchers have found that the vast majority, 78% of the general population, at least in the United States, shares your bias toward cutting more slack to your friends. 16% report that they are more balanced in their treatment of themselves and others. And finally, 6% say that they are more compassionate to themselves than others. Those folks are unlikely to buy this book. But the point of this reflection is not to highlight yet another way that you are not perfect, or to imply that there is something wrong with you for being so hard on yourself. Instead, you can actually take heart. Consider the fact that you already know how to cultivate compassion and kindness, because you admitted you can do it for your dear friends. Tip: all you have to do is orchestrate a U-turn on that compassion for others, and bingo, you've befriended yourself, and you are on the road to more self-compassion. Simple. But of course, not so easy. Whenever you may struggle to offer yourself compassion in a difficult moment, consider starting by asking yourself, how would I treat a good friend if they were going through what I'm going through? What would I say? What tone of voice would I use? What might I do to let them know that I am here for them? Asking yourself this question can jumpstart your practice when your self-compassion battery has run down. Understanding self-compassion. It's important to begin by being completely clear on what exactly self-compassion is, so that you can then proceed to cultivate it in your life. By necessity, this discussion must begin with Dr. Kristin Neff, an author and social psychologist who is the world's leading researcher and authority on self-compassion. Kristin's work, in collaboration with clinical psychologist Dr. Chris Germer, who was a pioneer in exploring the integration of psychology and contemplative practice, has resulted in the empirically supported Mindful Self-Compassion, MSC program, described later in this chapter. But beyond the development of MSC, Neff and Germer, through their writing, speaking, and research, have raised the profile of self-compassion in the popular consciousness and contributed to a new appreciation in clinical and contemplative circles for the role of self-compassion in resilience, well-being, and the relief of human suffering. Note, much of what I know about this topic and write about in this book is a direct result of studying the work of Chris and Kristin, and working closely with them as friends and colleagues, and as a teacher and teacher-trainer of MSC. Kristin Neff's research on the topic of self-compassion arose out of her own experience of discovering just how hard she was on herself as a graduate student. She thought it might be possible to cultivate a more harmonious relationship with herself through cultivating self-compassion. This direct personal experience led her to want to study the concept and understand it in a way that had not yet been researched. In turn, this led to a remarkable body of research that is cited widely around the globe, pointing to the benefits of self-compassion. Kristin developed the empirically supported self-compassion scale. I present a version of it in Chapter 2, which enabled her and her colleagues to more directly study self-compassion and begin to understand how it is related to various other things like mood, well-being, motivation, behavior change, and so on. Tip: if you're particularly interested in the research aspect of this topic, See Kristen's website, self-compassion.org, for a huge bibliography of published research studies on self-compassion. Compassion at the core. Remember, first and foremost, it's important to be completely clear that compassion is the foundation for everything that you discover and practice in this book. Whether you direct that compassion at others or yourself, the definition of compassion remains the same. A number of different authorities, from the Merriam-Webster Dictionary to the Dalai Lama, essentially define compassion in similar terms: the awareness of distress and the desire to alleviate that distress. Some use the term suffering instead of distress. But again, it's easiest to think of these as equivalent. Distress, suffering, stress, pain. This two-part definition, awareness of distress and the desire to alleviate it, helps to also clarify the difference between empathy and compassion, which is another question that people often have. In simple terms, empathy is the first part of the definition of compassion, without the second part. Empathy is the human capacity to relate to and sense another person's pain. Period. I often say that empathy is a one-way street in this regard, and it lacks the action component of compassion. One can have empathy for another person's struggle without having compassion. Most people tend to think of compassion as it relates to compassion for other people, which is probably why self-compassion gets lost in the shuffle, and so many of us are in need of a booster when it comes to directing this warmth toward ourselves. Self-compassion is simply the capacity to include ourselves within the circle of our compassion, a kind of compassionate U-turn. This may sound simple on the one hand, but if you've tried, you know that it can be challenging. To appreciate the elements involved in self-compassion, it may help to start with unpacking the experience of compassion for others. By doing so, you begin to see the connection between this and self-compassion. Take a moment to imagine a scenario where you are walking down the street and encounter a homeless woman sitting on the curb, rumpled, dirty, holding a paper cup for donations, and clearly suffering. As you consider this situation, what do you think would have to be present in you for compassion for this woman to arise? I often present this exercise when I speak about self-compassion, and invariably, the responses that I get are very similar, group after group. One can easily group the responses into three general areas that, remarkably enough, align with what Kristen Neff's research has uncovered regarding self-compassion. You have to even notice that the person is there. This is a way of saying that one has to first be mindful to actually notice that there is a person in front of you who is suffering. Without awareness, there is no possibility of compassion. And this awareness is referred to as mindfulness. The simple capacity to notice what is present in the moment without judgment is not so easy sometimes, but each of us possesses the ability. I realize that there but for the grace of God go I. The recognition that this person is a fellow human being who, just like me, wants to be happy and free from suffering is a powerful acknowledgement of what Kristen Neff calls common humanity. This ability to remember that all of us are human, all of us are imperfect, and that we need each other to survive is often forgotten when you are feeling isolated and different from others. But when you connect with it, it provides a solid support. I feel the desire to do something to help them out. Simply being aware or even noticing the common humanity does not automatically mean that compassion has arisen, unless it includes that action component of wanting to relieve the suffering or the difficulty. You can't always actively change the circumstances, but even in this scenario, noting the desire to relieve her suffering or offering the simple gift of eye contact or a smile may be an act of kindness that is possible in the moment. Mindfulness, common humanity, and kindness. These are the three components of self-compassion that have emerged from Kristen Neff's research, and they point the way forward for developing self-compassion if they are directed inwardly in the same way that most of us easily direct them outwardly. One way to capture this self-compassionate stance is by boiling it down to what my dear colleague Michelle Becker coined as a loving, connected presence. Remember, when you can be a loving, self-kindness, connected, common humanity, presence, mindfulness for yourself, you are practicing self-compassion. Much, much easier said than done, but a nice way to keep a simple vision of your intention going forward. Mindfulness. Chapter 4 explores the topic of mindfulness in greater depth, but for now it's helpful to get a basic grasp of how mindfulness plays a role in self-compassion and to contrast it with other ways of being that are less helpful or counterproductive to becoming more self-compassionate. With each of the three components, mindfulness, common humanity, and self-compassion, you may find it helpful to think of it as falling in the center of a continuum. In the case of mindfulness, it is the middle point between over-identification and being completely avoidant and checking out. For example, consider the situation where your partner is facing a difficult medical procedure and you are concerned, worried, or afraid about the outcome of the procedure. From the standpoint of awareness, you would be most supported by finding a space between the two possible extremes. Constantly ruminating over potential outcomes and becoming paralyzed with anxiety constitutes over-identification. Being totally checked out and in denial that something significant is happening to your beloved partner. Instead, you would want to stay connected, in tune with your reasonable fears, but not overwhelmed by them, so that you can be present and supportive of your partner in the process. This attentional middle ground is mindfulness. Common humanity. I cover the important role of common humanity in more detail in Chapter 5, but getting a general sense of it here can help ground you in the foundation of self-compassion. Returning to the metaphor of balance when looking at common humanity, you can probably relate to all points on that continuum. The extremes look like this. On one end of the scale is a deep and painful sense of isolation, loneliness, and feeling different from others, especially when you fail or fall short. When something goes wrong, you are convinced it is because you are somehow wrong or flawed or uniquely imperfect. On the other end of the spectrum are those times when you become so swallowed up in another's troubles that you lose yourself in the process and become overwhelmed. Calmly in the middle between these two extremes is a balanced sense of connection and commonality with your fellow human beings. A deep awareness that at times we all suffer, fall short, and fail. When you are resting in a sense of common humanity after having flubbed an important job interview, you recognize that your imperfections are not actually yours in the sense that all humans, and the other candidates for the job are imperfect. Rather than feeling uniquely flawed and fatally doomed to a life of mediocrity and solitude, you see this as one episode in a larger life. You can learn from your errors and perhaps seek the comfort of friends and colleagues who can relate with having had unfortunate experiences in key important situations. This is the healing power of common humanity. Self-kindness. Our innate inclination toward kindness and happiness is further explored in Chapter 6. And as the third component of self-compassion, it is the warm ribbon that ties all three together into a package of goodwill in the face of difficulty. As nice as you may feel when you can muster up some kindness for yourself in challenging times, it may feel incredibly elusive at other times. Opposite ends of the self-compassion spectrum look like this. Many people are more acutely aware of self-criticism, self-deprecation, and self-recrimination. You may be someone who lives with the voice of a harsh and judgmental inner critic, a constant badgering, undermining, and demeaning voice that pokes you unmercifully and may have been with you for as long as you can remember. More on working with the inner critic in Chapter 9. The other end of the spectrum is slightly more seductive and seems quite nice at first glance. But self-indulgence, just doing what feels good in the moment, regardless of whether it is exactly what you need or even in your best interests, is another extreme that does not support self-compassion. Self-kindness is that middle space that you might think of as the good parenting that you may or may not have had growing up. As an adult, you understand how to keep the big picture in mind when your son stays out past curfew because he was with friends having fun and lost track of the time. You know that berating him for being irresponsible and lazy is not a helpful way to react. However afraid you were that something had happened to him when he wasn't home at the appointed time. On the other hand, simply shrugging it off and saying, "That's okay, I'm just glad you're fine," may not be appropriate either, if you want him to develop responsibility and maturity. The reasonable, compassionate response is somewhere in between, where you make clear your expectations and how he violated them, provide appropriate consequences, and emphasize your love and respect for him. This is the balanced essence of kindness that is not indulgent, but not overly critical either. Looking at the yin and yang of self-compassion. Self-compassion suffers from what people in the public relations business call an image problem. Think about what comes to mind when you first see the phrase self-compassion, or what a stranger might think when they see the title of this book. I would be willing to bet that something comforting or soothing or cuddly springs to mind. Maybe the term conjures up the image of a rustic hot tub on a chilly autumn evening, or a warm cup of cocoa by the fire in the ski lodge. You might think of this practice as soothing, comforting, and nurturing. Something to do when you hit a bumpy stretch that helps you settle down and meet yourself with patience and kindness, the way you would counsel a good friend to handle such a situation. And you would not be wrong about that. But there is a whole other side of the practice that balances out this softer side of self-compassion and is equally important. You may have a tendency to see self-compassion as nurturing and soothing because our mental model of what compassion looks like usually comes from the example of how a mother may nurture or comfort her child when the child is upset or suffering. As a result, you are likely to link compassion more broadly to a more traditional feminine gender role. And therein lies the flaw in our appreciation of what compassion really includes. My goal here is to help illuminate your understanding of self-compassion so that you can appreciate its full expression, which will likely dispel some myths or misunderstandings you may have about the practice and allow you to open up to it more easily. Compassion can be best thought of as a complete whole that has a complementary side to this soft side as well. The other side of compassion, including self-compassion, is more stereotypically masculine and linked to action-oriented gender roles. Consider the job of the brave Coast Guardsman, the official title for a uniformed member of the U.S. Coast Guard, irrespective of gender. These individuals risk their lives, dangling out of helicopters to pluck hapless boaters from the icy waves and pulling shivering fishermen from the hulls of capsized boats. It's hard to imagine a more compassionate act than putting aside one's own safety for the good of another. There's nothing warm and fuzzy about that. Or in another scenario, imagine facing someone making an unwanted and uninvited romantic advance and needing to firmly say no to protect yourself. This is also an act of self-compassion that is more about strength and speaking your truth than soothing or comforting yourself. Taken together, we can appreciate that self-compassion has both tender, stereotypically feminine, and fierce, stereotypically masculine sides. They complement each other in a beautiful dance between being with ourselves in a compassionate way and acting in the world to get things done. In Chinese philosophy, this combination is represented by yin and yang, and indicates that all seemingly opposite attributes, like masculine, feminine, light, dark, and active, passive, are complementary and interdependent. This idea is represented by the familiar symbol shown in Figure 1-1. The yin side is most associated with the tender aspect of comforting, soothing, and validating ourselves in times of great difficulty. On the flip side, the yang aspect of self-compassion is linked to fiercely protecting ourselves, providing for our needs, and motivating ourselves to take action. All of these are self-compassion, and all are ultimately in our own best interests, but in quite different and complementary forms. Remember, it is notable that each side of the symbol contains a dot of the other side within it, showing that neither side loses touch with the other. For example, imagine finding out that you failed an important test because your professor accidentally told you to read the wrong chapter in the textbook. You are fuming over the unfairness of it and considering writing a nasty email to the professor that vents a semester's worth of frustration in a couple of paragraphs. You pause for a moment and simply acknowledge the situation by saying to yourself, "This is really unfair, and it hurts to feel this anger right now." In this moment, you are both validating your anger in a yin way by naming it and acknowledging that it is hard, but it also requires a dot of yang strength to resolve to be willing to turn toward your anger first, when you really want to discharge it with a nasty email that will certainly make things worse. Taken together, the yin and yang energy of self-compassion support us in making wiser, more effective choices that are ultimately in our best interests. Yin sights. Make no mistake, the fact that you are considering becoming more self-compassionate is a big deal. And it won't always be easy. It will be especially hard because you have a lifetime's experience of probably being less compassionate with yourself than you could have been, or even downright mean to yourself at times. If you've experienced a breakup initiated by the other person, Maybe you ruminate for hours, days, or even weeks over what you must have done wrong or how you could have been so terrible. Do you hear the voice of an inner critic berating you for not being enough? Tolerant enough? Loving enough? Fun enough? For any one of a million reasons and a multitude of life experiences, you may have developed a tendency to be less than yin with yourself when you encounter failure, frustration, disappointment, or imperfection in yourself. It happens. Could you possibly even pause and forgive yourself just now, simply because that has been your experience in the past? At first, when you make a commitment to be as kind to yourself as you are with your dear friends when they face the same hardships, it may feel weird, unfamiliar. It may feel like you just slipped your left foot into your right shoe. But see if you can be patient with yourself and the discomfort and continue to offer the natural kindness that you show your friends. Let it envelop you and warm your heart. Stay curious and see what may arise if this time you let yourself receive a little bit of your own kindness. Again, patience is the key. Perhaps your go-to response when you face difficulties is to beat yourself up for falling short, harangue yourself for being imperfect, or take action that you may later regret. See if you can, for just this moment, let those harsh voices be there, but in the background, and make a little space for another voice that may be very quiet or timid just now. For just this one moment, try simply soothing yourself for having a hard time for no other reason than you are having it. Tip: the next time you are aware that you're feeling uncomfortable or upset in some way, try the simple experiment of simply placing a hand on your body someplace that is soothing or supportive and notice how that feels. Nothing else. Notice if you have thoughts and see if you can see them just scroll across your awareness like those stock tickers on Wall Street. Don't give them any importance by trying to argue with them or answer them. Just focus on what it feels like to comfort and soothe yourself in a moment of difficulty. It's perfectly natural to do this. Give yourself full permission to feel your own compassion in the form of warm, supportive touch for as long as you like. What are you aware of when you do this? What is the yin sight that you discover by accessing, even for a moment, the warm, feminine, nurturing side of self-compassion? Yang sights. One of the most common hesitations that people have about practicing self-compassion is their sense that it is a kind of passive, it's all good kind of response to every situation. Nothing could be further from the truth when you look a bit closer. But it's worth exploring a bit more deeply to fully grasp the potential strength, power, and resolve that is inherent in self-compassion. It can be helpful to differentiate between feelings and our responses to those feelings, because this is where the rubber meets the road in self-compassion. Have you ever tried to change an emotion that you were experiencing? We often do, but we rarely succeed. Perhaps you are angry because someone disrespected you, and you are fuming and ruminating over this injustice and telling a friend all about it. Think about how it would feel if your friend told you, "Just stop being so angry. Get over it." My guess is this would just intensify your anger, now including your friend for telling you not to be angry. I talk more in Chapter 3 about the consequences of resisting the reality of feelings and facts, but just now we can suffice to say that trying not to feel a feeling is nearly impossible, despite how often we try to do it. Take even the old example of inadvertently getting the giggles in a funeral service or some other serious gathering. Have you ever tried to stop the giggles in that moment? How did that work out? Remember, self-compassion teaches us to simply meet ourselves with kindness because we are having difficult feelings without the agenda to make them go away, which is usually impossible anyway. But the key to Yang compassion in particular is to know that simply comforting and soothing ourselves because we feel badly may be only half of the equation. Once we can fully acknowledge simply the presence of a feeling or a problem of some kind, we can also potentially chart a course of wise action in response. Sometimes the wise action that is called for is actually to choose inaction. Perhaps in a situation where someone has done something hurtful to you and is still angry and may continue to do the harm, the wisest way forward is to move backward in that moment and wait to advocate for yourself in more supportive circumstances. But sometimes you need to step up and speak your truth, say no to things that you truly see as clearly wrong or hurtful, or make changes that need to be made. In each of these cases, a conscious choice to act, through speaking up when you might have stayed quiet, saying no when you mean it, changing your behavior because you see that it is not in your best interest, or simply not acting because action would not serve you in the long run, is a true act of self-compassion. When you access the yang side of compassion, you hold the truth of your feelings but let them inform and energize you for action so that you focus on the things that need to be done. This is very far from passivity and looks a lot more like wisdom, seeing the whole situation from the larger perspective and choosing a response that best suits it. Tip: as you have been practicing thus far, the next time you face a challenging situation where you feel overwhelmed, powerless, or helpless in the face of it, see if you can maintain some patience and curiosity to explore it a bit further than usual. You might temporarily soothe yourself with some yin compassion by resting a hand on your body or even giving yourself a brief inner pep talk along the lines of, "You've got this," to just cultivate a bit of clarity and ease within you. With a little space and time to allow the adrenaline to loosen its grip on your nervous system, see if there is any indication of something that needs to be done or something you really need in this moment. Whether you provide for your needs simply by validating your emotions and not acting, or stand up to someone who is causing harm, or simply resolve to make change in the future, these can all be important expressions of yang, active, self-compassion. What fierce and tender sound like in your head? It's all well and good to talk about yin and yang compassion in the abstract, but if you're like me, you're a practical person, and you want to know how it actually plays out in real life. You can't always stop and affectionately place your hands on your heart in a moment of suffering. Imagine doing that while making a presentation to the board of directors or with your fellow firefighters on the way to a fire. And other times, you need to give yourself a kick in the pants. But despite the fact that that term is a cliche, I haven't yet figured out how to physically pull it off. So sometimes, the best way to recognize the quality of your attention is to take note of what you say to yourself and the tone you use. To get you started, I've provided a short list of phrases you may consider or already use to access each of the two sides of self-compassion. Try them out. Write them down. Tattoo them on your forearm, whatever works for you to be able to access them when you need them most. And if you forget to use them when you could have used them, don't beat yourself up. Just recognize that even that oversight is just another opportunity to be self-compassionate. Yang self-talk. "You've got this, big guy." "This crappy situation doesn't define you." "Your voice matters here. Speak your truth." You've faced hard times before and you can do it again. You belong, you matter, you have something to contribute. How great would it feel to get a little exercise right now? WWJD, what would Jesus do? Remember, discretion is the better part of valor. Let's do this. Ah. Yin self-talk. Oh man, this is so hard right now. There's nothing to change, sweetheart. It's okay for now. I'm here for you. You're not alone. Aw. This is big. It's okay to go slow. You're doing the best you can, darling. Right now, it's like this, and that's okay. What do you need right now, my friend? What do you need to hear? Balancing soothing and strong. As you have probably already discovered, self-compassion is not really yin or yang, but yin and yang. Just like the light and dark sides of the moon, these are part and parcel of each other, and one does not exist without the other. So self-compassion is neither all soft, warm and fuzzy, nor all strong, bold and active. It is a complementary blend of these qualities that balance out each other and support us in navigating in a wise and balanced way. If we are too yin, we become too passive, accepting and wishy-washy, and we are vulnerable to being taken advantage of, mistreated, or simply self-absorbed. When we have all yang with no yin, we risk reacting without wisdom because our emotions are not acknowledged and held so that they can truly inform and guide us in the actions we choose. Instead, they lead us to impulsive actions that have negative consequences. Finding a balance between yin and yang is not an easy task, but it is well worth the effort. I find it particularly helpful to really tune in to how my body feels when I'm practicing self-compassion and to fine-tune my practice to find a kind of balanced inner state that is somewhere between soothing and strong. That balance point is different in different situations. So it all comes down to the fundamental question of self-compassion. What do I need? Remember, if you can become aware of your inner state in a given moment, you may notice a feeling of passivity or helplessness that can be balanced by some validation or accessing of a protective yang energy. On the other hand, if you feel a sense of ferocity that is unleashing a slightly unpredictable inner tiger, you may warm up the inner environment with some soothing words. I'm partial to, "Whoa, big guy, hold on there," as one example. These two complementary forces combine to help you find the wise way through tough spots, holding you when you need to be held, propelling you when you need to take action. Always with that little dot from the yin-yang diagram of warmth in the yang and action in the yin to hold it all together. Asking the fundamental question of self-compassion. In the end, for all the components and facets and considerations about self-compassion, it boils down to developing our capacity to ask and respond to a very simple question. What do I need? That's it. It's no more complex than simply stopping in a moment, or a whole stream of moments, and checking to respond to what is present for you and to see what you need. The act of stopping itself is an act of kindness, and it creates a space for you to step out of the stream, or raging river of life, and to see with clarity and kindness what you may need. Okay, although it is simple, I'm not suggesting that it's easy. otherwise, Kristen Neff and Chris Germer would not have dedicated their entire professional careers to understanding, exploring, and sharing the practice. And I wouldn't have taken the time to write this book. But at its core, it comes down to this simple question and how we answer it. As I noted earlier, this is generally easy enough for most of us to do for our friends and loved ones when they struggle, face failure, or have a hard time. But so often we look past our own struggles and pain, ignore them, deny them, or push them aside for whatever reason. All to be explored in the pages ahead. Remember. But there is profound truth in the statement, sometimes attributed to the Buddha, you, yourself, as much as anybody in the entire universe, deserve your love and affection. Why not? Who are you not to deserve your own kindness, patience, and care? Introducing the Mindful Self-Compassion Program. In 2009, Chris Germer published The Mindful Path to Self-Compassion, which was the culmination of many years of contemplative practice, clinical experience, and training. Chris's personal journey, much like Kristen's, which was detailed in her own book, Self-Compassion, had led him to his life's work of teaching and speaking about integrating self-compassion practice into daily life and into psychotherapy to support people in feeling happier, more fulfilled, and able to overcome challenging histories. In 2008, Chris and Kristen, at the time mere distant colleagues, were invited to participate in an important meeting of the Mind and Life Institute in upstate New York, and Chris offered to give Kristen a ride to that conference. On the auspicious journey back to the airport after the conference, the Mindful Self-Compassion MSC program was born. I like to joke that the two of them were like those old commercials for Reese's Peanut Butter Cups. Kristen was the social psychologist who had done significant research on self-compassion, but never considered herself someone who could teach the practice to others. Chris was a well-respected clinical psychologist with years of experience, study, and teaching of the practical application of self-compassion with a relatively modest research background. Chris and Kristen each started out suggesting the other was the perfect person to create a self-compassion training program, and ultimately decided that they were better together than apart. In the commercials, one person enjoying peanut butter accidentally bumps into someone eating chocolate, and their foodstuffs intermingle. "Hey, you got peanut butter on my chocolate," says one. The other indignantly retorts, "Hey, you got chocolate in my peanut butter." They each taste the magical combination, and the rest is history. Such was the case with mindful self-compassion as well. Working together and drawing on their respective experience and study, Chris and Kristen developed the program that they first offered at a workshop in 2010 at the fabled Esalen Institute on the Central California coast. Despite the later success, it was an inauspicious beginning, as 12 people had signed up for the course and 3 dropped out within a day or so. These days, their programs draw huge crowds. Kristen and Chris later conducted a randomized control trial of the MSC program with very promising results, pointing to increased self-compassion as a result of the training, an important first point to establish, that one can actually learn to be more self-compassionate, as well as improved mood and greater quality of life, among other findings. The MSC program has since grown and improved year by year, with the help and support of the Nonprofit Center for Mindful Self-Compassion, the organization for which I work as the executive director, and over 2,700 people are now trained to teach the program worldwide. Research on MSC continues, And it is estimated that over 100,000 people worldwide have experienced the program in one form or another. The teachers continue to report remarkable impact on the participants in their courses. This book, and the vast majority of meditations, exercises, and topics in it, are largely inspired by and drawn from the MSc program and my experience of learning and teaching it. It is a powerful and empirically supported way of systematically developing greater self-compassion. I highly recommend MSc for those who find the material in this book to be helpful. The opportunity to discover and practice self-compassion in the context of a group, whether in person or online, is tremendously valuable because of the greater sense of common humanity, among many other reasons. Practice. The self-compassion break. Play. This is the quintessential practice taken directly from the Mindful Self-Compassion Program and is perfectly suited to support you in deploying the three components of self-compassion in a moment of difficulty. I present it here like a formal meditation, but this is only to help you become familiar with the practice. The real value is in practicing it when you face a difficult moment or time when you are feeling distressed or upset in some way. But for now, give yourself this opportunity to become familiar with the practice. Follow these steps. 1. Begin by taking some time to relax. Allow your gaze to soften and your face to relax. Notice your body sitting here. Perhaps take note of your breath moving in and out, over and over, as it does whether we are attending to it or not. 2. Call to mind a situation in your life that is difficult right now and causing you stress. It may be a health issue, a challenging relationship, a work problem, or perhaps stress related to one of your identities, such as your gender, race, ethnicity, age, or ability. Do your best to choose a problem in the mild to moderate range, not a big problem. Remember, this time through, you are just learning this skill of self-compassion, perhaps for the first time. 3. Give yourself time to really bring the situation to mind, to see, hear, and feel your way into the problem, perhaps enough so that you notice some uneasiness or discomfort in your body associated with it. Where do you happen to feel it most just now? See if you can have a sense of where it is in the body and simply open up to noticing it as it is. 4. As you sense the discomfort in your awareness, note to yourself, slowly and clearly, this is a moment of suffering. This is mindfulness, simply opening awareness to what is present. Other words you might use are, ouch, or this hurts, or this is painful. Take your time and acknowledge what is here for you. 5. Say to yourself slowly and clearly, suffering is a part of living. This is common humanity, as you note that all humans have moments like this. You may say instead, I'm not alone, or me too. Or others in my community would feel a lot like me in a situation like this. Remember that suffering is a universal experience, even though it is not equal across individuals or groups. Maybe you can have a sense of at least one person similar to yourself who may feel this like you do. 6. Place your open palms over your heart, or wherever it may feel supportive to you, feeling the warmth and tenderness of your touch. You might say to yourself, may I be kind to myself, or may I give myself what I need. This is the self-kindness that we often long for but may not receive from ourselves. You can even explore just what kind of self-compassion you need just now, whether it is yin compassion or yang compassion. Yin might be, may I accept myself as I am, or may I bring tenderness to myself just now. If you feel that yang is more appropriate, you might say, no, I will not allow this to continue, or perhaps, may I have the courage and strength to make a change when I can. Tip: if you find it hard to locate just the right words for yourself at any point in this self-compassion break, you might consider imagining what would flow from your heart and mouth if a dear friend were facing a similar situation. What would you say to them, heart to heart, if they were feeling this discomfort? Once you've identified some words, can you offer those same words to yourself as well? 7. Whenever you are ready and you feel you've given yourself what you need, allow your gaze to raise and your eyes to take in your surroundings. Take some time to settle, reflect, and perhaps take notes. Inquiring. What arose for you when you took a self-compassion break? Notice that the self-compassion break incorporates the three components of self-compassion: mindfulness, common humanity, and self-kindness, as well as the two sides of self-compassion, yin and yang, all wrapped up in a fairly straightforward practice. As I note in the preceding section, this practice is intended for you to deploy at a moment's notice when you become aware of struggle, pain, or stress in a moment. It can be as simple and brief as stepping through the three components in a cascade for a few seconds, or creating some time and space to linger with each element of the break. Whatever is needed and possible in a moment. Reflect on the break afterward by considering the following questions. When you called to mind the difficult situation, how was that for you? What was most noticeable when you imagined the difficult situation? What was your experience in each of the three steps of the self-compassion break? What was it like to acknowledge mindfulness, common humanity, and self-kindness? Do you think you can use this practice in the future, the next time you face a challenge or difficulty? Give it a try and see if you can do a self-compassion break a time or two in the next day or so, and see what happens and what you notice. Let go of needing anything to change just yet, and be patient with yourself as you slowly develop this capacity to respond differently in challenging situations. This will all take time, and we are only just beginning. By the way, it is possible that you found placing your hands over your heart not particularly supportive or pleasant. A certain percentage of people find this to be the case. For now, be willing to experiment and see if there are other places on the body that may be better for you. Chapter 2 gives you an opportunity to explore other options for this soothing and supportive touch. One last note. In this practice run, I invited you to call to mind a difficult situation in order to have a problem to work with as you begin to practice the process. I am absolutely not suggesting that you continue to do this, pausing now and then to call to mind a challenging situation to practice. Trust me, life will do quite a good job of handing you all the difficulties you need to master the practice. There's no need for you to open yourself to additional unnecessary suffering. Just be patient and begin to notice when it happens. And it will. Chapter 2. Enjoying the Benefits of Self-Compassion. In this chapter, seeing the science behind self-compassion. Feeling self-criticism and self-compassion in the body. Quelling doubts and hesitations about self-compassion. Let's face it, nobody buys a book like this because everything is feeling just peachy in their life. Whether it's calculus for dummies, or cooking for dummies, or self-compassion for dummies, we buy these books because we're not satisfied with our current state of affairs relative to the topic, calculus, cooking, or self-compassion, and want to make a change. It all starts with a seed of discontent, a tug of self-doubt, or even a sharp hot jab of emotional pain or suffering. Think about it. As you're reading this book, you're probably focused on how bad it feels to criticize yourself, or how hard it is when you expect perfection, or the dark rabbit hole you retreat into when things go badly for you. In broad terms, you're coming here to get away from your suffering and pain. Indeed, you've come to the right place. But discomfort only gets the ball rolling. And the good news is that we can overcome this preoccupation with the negative and the hurtful, and instead find what is possible when we treat ourselves as kindly as we typically treat others. So even if pain brought you to the dance, so to speak, it doesn't have to be your primary dance partner. In fact, you may be shocked to find out that you can become more self-compassionate without ditching your inner critic by the punch bowl. The promise and power of self-compassion is that when we begin to treat ourselves with warmth, patience, and encouragement, we open up a whole new way of living and being in the world. The science is clear that when we are more self-compassionate, we are more able to bounce back in the face of life's challenges, our relationships are more rewarding, we are willing to take risks and try harder to achieve our goals, and we are able to navigate our lives in more satisfying and fruitful ways. And it all begins with how we treat ourselves. In this chapter, you discover the tremendous benefits of becoming more self-compassionate that extend well beyond relief of emotional pain. You see that you already have this capacity within you, and it is an innate capacity that science shows you can cultivate over time. You find out how accessing the self-compassionate part of you affects your body, your mind, and your emotions. I also explore with you some of the most common misconceptions about self-compassion and the doubts that you probably have right now about what it would mean for you if you became more self-compassionate. What science says about self-compassion? Over 2,000 research studies have been conducted to study self-compassion in one way or another, and the body of research is growing exponentially, suggesting that we may be onto something here with this new way of being with ourselves. In the following section, you discover, using scientifically solid data, just how self-compassionate you are, whether you really want to know or not, and then explore what researchers have found out about how this way of being with yourself actually plays out in your daily life. Measuring how compassionate you really are toward yourself. Dr. Kristen Neff's research has led the way in this important area of study, and she is the developer of the Self-Compassion Scale, SCS, which is a quick way of measuring just how self-compassionate you are. The SCS is by far the most used measure of self-compassion by researchers around the globe. Tip. As a step on your self-compassion journey, you may want to consider making an objective assessment of just how self-compassionate you are by completing the following adapted version of the short form of the SCS. The SCS measures how mindful people are versus how over-identified they get with their own struggles, how deeply they feel a sense of common humanity versus feeling isolated by their own imperfection, the degree to which people are routinely kind to themselves versus unkind. If you would like to complete the full self-compassion scale and have your results calculated automatically, go to self-compassion.com. bookstore.org/test-how-self-compassionate-you-are. The following statements describe how you act toward yourself in difficult times. Listen to each statement carefully before answering, and to the left of each item, indicate how often you behave in the stated manner, on a scale of 1 to 5, with 1 being almost never, and 5 being almost always. Note that the meaning of your rating varies with each group of items as shown. I try to be understanding and patient toward those aspects of my personality I don't like. When something painful happens, I try to take a balanced view of the situation. I try to see my failings as part of the human condition. When I'm going through a very hard time, I give myself the caring and tenderness I need. When something upsets me, I try to keep my emotions in balance. When I feel inadequate in some way, I try to remind myself that feelings of inadequacy are shared by most people. For the next set of items, rate each item on a scale of 1 to 5, with 1 being almost always and 5 being almost never. When I fail at something important to me, I become consumed by feelings of inadequacy. When I'm feeling down, I tend to feel like most other people are probably happier than I am. When I fail at something that's important to me, I tend to feel alone in my failure. When I'm feeling down, I tend to obsess and fixate on everything that's wrong. I'm disapproving and judgmental about my own flaws and inadequacies. I'm intolerant and impatient toward those aspects of my personality I don't like. How to score your test. Total, sum of all 12 items. Mean score equals total divided by 12. Average overall self-compassion scores tend to be around 3 on the 1 to 5 scale, so you can interpret your overall score accordingly. As a rough guide, a score of 1 to 2.5 for your overall self-compassion score indicates you are low in self-compassion. 2.5 through 3.5 indicates you are moderate, and 3.5 to 5.0 means you are high in self-compassion. The SCS is a valuable measure of just how self-compassionate a person is, and it forms the heart of a remarkable body of research that I refer to from time to time in this chapter and throughout the book. But it's important to appreciate that no amount of science by itself can make you more self-compassionate. I share this important information to reassure you that what you are considering here has science behind it and that there is strong evidence for its contribution to a life well lived. The research, much of it done by Kristen Neff, is clear in pointing to the tight linkage between self-compassion and a number of important life dimensions, including emotional well-being. ADSCO. Regardless of the score you achieved on the self-compassion scale, there's no need to be concerned and certainly no reason to begin criticizing yourself for not being kinder, perhaps the most ironic form of self-compassion. Instead, see if you can let this be ADSCO, another damned self-compassion opportunity. We include the expletive because what we really want is to be free of the self-criticism and keep hoping that the next time something hard happens to us, we will finally be rid of the old way of being. But think about this. You've had a lifetime to build up a mental and emotional habit of responding to adversity with perfectionism, self-criticism, and shame. Why would you expect that a few weeks into trying something different, all that mental training will simply dissolve in a moment of rapture? This is a process that takes time, And each time we face an ADSCO, perhaps it gets a tiny bit easier to shift our old patterns. We can think of these ADSCOs as tiny shifts in course by an ocean liner. When the ship leaving San Francisco turns a half degree farther south than it usually does, it's barely noticeable at first. But played out over thousands of miles, it can mean the difference between arriving in Japan and arriving in Fiji. We can celebrate the ADSCOs as little moments of tiny course adjustments that, over time, make a big difference in our lives. As you explore self-compassion for yourself, you are likely to find no end to the ADSCOs as you tune in to the inner dialogue of your inner critic, a virtual inner radio station that is often playing in the background of your life, serving up pokes and prods and unwanted color commentary on your behavior. More on the critic in Chapter 9. When you are practicing a new skill or developing a new resource like self-compassion, it's much like exercising. The more opportunities you have to practice, exercise, the stronger and more self-compassionate you get. When you're out on a walk with your cocker spaniel and you accidentally step in Fido's poop and begin to berate yourself for your mindlessness, ADSCO. When you get that panicked sinking feeling because you accidentally included your boss on an email you didn't want them to see and you are already considering clearing out your desk, ADSCO. The more you practice, the more you grow. Bring on the ADSCOs and watch your SCS score rise. Emotional well-being. Speaking generally, studies have shown that self-compassion is linked to less depression, anxiety, and stress. Other studies that look at collections of similar kinds of research have shown quite clearly that as self-compassion increases, psychological distress decreases. This is referred to as an inverse correlation. For example, the more money you have in the bank, the less anxiety you have about paying your bills. Of course, a key feature of self-compassion is that you don't criticize yourself as much. And the research is clear that self-criticism contributes to anxiety and depression. But even more than that, self-compassion turns out to actually protect us against these same difficulties. Self-compassion makes us more immune to life's trials that could otherwise send us into bouts of intense panic or deep sadness. People who are more self-compassionate are less susceptible to the harmful impact of stress because they take stressful events in stride as simply a part of life rather than a catastrophe to be avoided or resisted. Self-compassion becomes a kind of shock absorber on the car of life and allows us to navigate our way more smoothly along all of life's bumpy roads. You may have heard the term emotional intelligence, which is really a fancy way of referring to how well you cope with the reality of being a human being who has emotions. Are you able to be informed and guided by your emotions, both pleasant and unpleasant, without being overwhelmed or carried away by them? The degree to which you can navigate the territory of emotions reflects how emotionally intelligent you are. Remember, in general, self-compassion is associated with greater emotional intelligence, which means that people who are more self-compassionate are able to deal with their emotions in wiser and more productive ways. This means that if you are more self-compassionate, you are less likely to ruminate, literally to chew over, your negative thoughts and emotions, like a cow chews her cud. With self-compassion, you can avoid the emotional quagmire of negative thinking and self-blame, and instead see emotions as helpful guideposts and experiences to be savored or appreciated when they arise. In a number of interesting studies designed to elicit feelings of shame or deep embarrassment, sign me up, researchers found that people who are more self-compassionate tended to feel less shame. When people were prompted to be more self-compassionate, they also felt less shame in similar situations than those who were not prompted to be kind to themselves. It's worthwhile to note that, in keeping with the focus in this chapter on the particular benefits of self-compassion, this practice also appears to bolster feelings of well-being, life satisfaction, hope, happiness, optimism, gratitude, curiosity, vitality, and positive emotion. In fact, researchers have found that self-compassion bolsters the very pillars of well-being: autonomy, competence, and relatedness. So, practicing self-compassion can support you in feeling your own power and ability to make things happen, your confidence in your own abilities, and your sense of connection to others. Not a bad combination at all to set one up for facing the world. The self-compassion trap. You may be surprised to learn that self-esteem is a bit of a sneaky character. The importance of fostering high self-esteem in our children to protect them against the thorny challenges of life has become conventional wisdom, and we still see the effects of that movement in many areas of education and society. I like to call it the Every Child Gets a Trophy movement, wherein well-meaning parents, teachers, and coaches celebrate every child, as they should, and then recognize them with awards, certificates, trophies, and so forth, regardless of how they perform or whether they actually earned them. And to add insult to injury, even the heroes, the best athletes, the most accomplished students and musicians are not singled out for recognition for their outstanding performances out of concern that such accolades will lower the self-esteem of the other kids, making them feel bad. It is indeed true that research has revealed that high self-esteem is definitely related to many positive things in life, such as successful relationships, improved work satisfaction, and better health. Furthermore, we know that people with low self-esteem are more susceptible to things like anxiety, depression, and even the likelihood to attempt suicide. And all of this would lead one to think that we should do whatever we can to increase self-esteem in our children. That's exactly what researchers thought late in the 20th century, and how we came to be handing out trophies like candy on Halloween. The trouble with self-esteem. So, what's wrong with high self-esteem, you ask? Nothing really, if it arises naturally. But the way you go about achieving high self-esteem is the real test. Self-esteem is a way of viewing ourselves that is conditional, meaning that we look at ourselves, or a particular feature of ourselves, such as how we look or what we have accomplished, and compare that feature to others to decide how good we are. As a result, we gain self-esteem if we look around and decide that we are better looking than our friends, or if the boss says more nice things about our project than a coworker's. We comfort ourselves by believing that we are above average at nearly everything. Studies have shown that all people tend to believe that they are above average drivers, parents, and dancers. But you don't have to be a statistician to know that everyone cannot be above average. The concept of average doesn't work like that. In truth, most of us are average drivers, parents, and dancers, because that's how average works. In normal situations, about 68% of us fall in the normal range on nearly everything. But think about this. Imagine you just came off the dance floor with your sweetheart, out of breath and beaming about your rendition of the electric slide as the last disco notes fade into the crowd noise. How would you feel if a friend sidled up next to you at the bar and enthusiastically said, "That was a really average set of dance moves you just demonstrated"? I imagine you would be devastated to hear those words from a dear friend, even though they very well may be true. We operate in the world believing that we are above average because it helps us feel good about ourselves. This view helps us maintain our self-esteem. But then, when we are confronted with reality, we are in serious trouble. We lose the dance contest, or we fail a test, or we drop a platter of dishes in the restaurant and our self-esteem plummets. We berate ourselves for being so inept, so stupid, so fallible, so human. And we struggle to find our way back to some sense of ease about ourselves. Some of us spend our lives trying to claw our way back from feeling above average in something, anything, and suffer mightily in the effort because we need to feel or look or dance better than someone else. We can be totally dependent on our environment for our sense of self-worth, meaning that our whole lives become conditional upon conditions that are often outside of our control. The conditional nature of self-esteem. When we have high self-esteem, we feel great. When we have low self-esteem, we feel terrible, and everything hinges on where we are and with whom we compare ourselves. The darkest side of this needing to feel better or more worthy than others is that it can also lead us to put others down, dismiss them, or even bully them to make us feel better about ourselves. The unfortunate slippery slope of this approach is that when we do this, we often feel worse about ourselves for having done it, berate ourselves further, and dig ourselves deeper in a low self-esteem pit that can be associated with further bullying, deeper depression, and deeper shame. As you may imagine, self-esteem is a bit of a roller coaster ride at times and can be as elusive and changeable as the weather. The research supports this view in many ways, and also highlights how self-compassion is so much more stable, supportive, and reliable for people and avoids the pitfalls of self-esteem. For example, studies have shown that people who are more self-compassionate have more stable feelings of self-worth than those who simply have high self-esteem. Interestingly, high self-esteem is closely associated with narcissism, which is rampant in our society today. Narcissism is an inflated and unrealistically positive view of ourselves. All in all, the research suggests that, in contrast with those who have high self-esteem, self-compassionate people are less likely to be constantly evaluating themselves, feeling superior to others, defending their viewpoints, or angrily reacting against people who disagree with them. These sound like the kind of people I'd like to hang out with. How about you? How self-compassion beats self-esteem. From another perspective, self-compassion is more helpful to us in coping with stress than self-esteem is, and equips us to handle all types of feedback, positive, neutral, negative, from others better than self-esteem does, especially when that feedback is neutral or negative. The good news here is that self-compassion is a better way of navigating life's challenges that is not at all conditional in any way, can be relied upon in any circumstance, and is always available to us whenever we need it. Not only is it powerful and present to us, but it also supports us to grow and to take in new information and constructive feedback so that we can improve our performance, consider our options, and learn from our experience. Remember, self-compassion is not sugarcoating our view of the world or shielding us from challenges. It actually allows us to take it all in and meet life head-on with inner strength and resilience. Self-esteem is a positive evaluation of your own self-worth, whereas self-compassion is not an evaluation at all, but a way of relating kindly to who we are, especially when we feel inadequate or have suffered a misfortune. Exploring the physiology of self-criticism and self-compassion. Have you ever been physically harmed by a nasty email you received? Were you ever actually in danger when a zombie popped out of nowhere in a movie? Of course not. We don't think twice about these instances and others where we find that we are alerted to some form of threat in our vicinity, real or imagined. But they explain a lot about how and why we have stress in our lives, and also provide us some clues for how to deal with this stress. Our bodies have been intricately designed to perpetuate our existence. We are psychologically wired to keep ourselves alive and procreating. If you're reading these lines, then this evolutionary process has been successful regarding the former, and you may even enjoy the latter from time to time as well. Our physiology has been working efficiently for millennia, such that it has allowed us to survive and thrive as a species. But the challenge is that we are now carrying the ancient day-to-day survival baggage of our ancestors into a life that rarely directly threatens our physical safety or our life. Imagine showing up with a wooden spear to play NFL football, for example. There's no doubt that your weapon might deter the opposition, but it is far outside the rules of modern sport to carry one. You could say that we are the victims of our own success as a species. After generations of scrambling to survive, avoiding danger, outsmarting predators, conquering most disease and hunger, and generally building a lifestyle of comfort and ease, we can finally relax and appreciate it all and count our remarkable blessings, right? Not so much. Perhaps now and then we stop and smell the flowers of our lives and appreciate what we have. In the United States, we have one day a year devoted to pausing and giving thanks for all that we have been given by life, and then we spend most of the other 364 days clamoring to get the things we don't have, to do things that we believe will make us feel more secure, more safe, and more complete. We can't seem to help ourselves, and it's largely because of this ancient brain that we have inherited that is always on the lookout for danger, threat, or problems. But as Paul Gilbert, the noted British psychologist, is fond of saying, it's not our fault, but it is our responsibility. Remember, in other words, just because we have inherited this hunter-gatherer brain, we are still not doomed to live the life of our cave-dwelling ancestors. We've got options. But first, we need to appreciate just how that ancient brain influences us in our daily lives and exactly how the practice of compassion and self-compassion can help us access other human systems to overcome those roots and become fully modern humans who are satisfied, fulfilled, and happy, even while possessing seemingly outdated hardware between our ears. The brain we share with our ancestors. At the most basic reptilian level, humans have had to find a way to avoid pain and danger. Like the lowest forms of life, amoebas and plankton, we humans are equipped with systems that propel us toward what we need and want, and away from things that we don't need or would be harmful to us. Our reflexes make us recoil from a hot pan on the stove and also cause our mouths to water at the delicious soup inside. Thankfully, we are built in more complex ways than amoeba and plankton, largely because those organisms are not good at soup making and have no opposable thumbs, among other more noteworthy shortcomings as life forms. No offense, my little friends. Our human autopiloting system. What humans are blessed with is a system called the autonomic nervous system, ANS, that tends to all our bodily processes, maintains our temperature, is the caretaker of our internal organs, makes sure we are able to digest our food and expel waste, and oversees all the other multiple functions that keep us alive. Within the ANS are two complementary subsystems that dance together to make sure the body responds appropriately, depending on the situation. When the body needs to be prepared for a threatening or dangerous situation, for example, a leopard pouncing on you from a tree, the sympathetic nervous system, SNS, kicks into gear with what is referred to as the fight or flight response. Under ordinary situations, seeing a sleeping leopard at the zoo, the parasympathetic nervous system, PNS, takes care of us by calming us and helping our body conserve and restore resources. When our SNS, or threat defense system, is activated, it starts with the triggering of the amygdala, a brain structure designed specifically to sound the alarm and prepare us to fight, flee, or freeze. Your three options when under attack. The SNS then uses chemical messengers, neurotransmitters, like acetylcholine and norepinephrine, to bring about certain reactions in the body. These reactions include elevating your heart rate to prepare you to fight, slowing down digestion to prioritize quick metabolism of fat and sugar for a sudden flight, constriction of blood vessels in some parts of the body, in arms and legs to prevent bleeding out if you are injured, dilation of blood vessels in other parts for muscle activation, and tunnel vision that facilitates you being laser-focused on the threat ahead of you. You know the feeling of SNS activation, because it's what hits you when you get that nasty email, when someone cuts you off in traffic, or when you hear a loud crash in the other room in the middle of the night. Eventually, if there is no actual threat to your survival or safety, the neurotransmitters begin to be broken down by the body, metabolized, and the PNS can begin to do its work of calming and soothing your body to bring it back down to baseline. It may be helpful to see how the components of the stress response of the SNS unfold within us and how the three components of self-compassion can be the antidote to this process. Check out Table 2-1. Table 2-1. Self-compassion and the stress response. Stress response, fight. Stress response turned inward.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.